Okay, we're in the home stretch here. We talked about their growth rate. I got behind this 15.6% growth rate, and going in down here to look at how those trends have been going. It looks pretty good over the term for owner's earnings here. Growth rate was pretty low, but it jumps up, and then over the last couple of years, it's been pretty high. It's been 8%, but over the 10-year period, and you look at their 10-year growth rate, it's consistently in around 20. They have this little dip over this 5-year period, but it bounced right back here. If you look at this 10-year period, 2003 to 2012, 25% growth over the last 10 years. That's very solid. That's a nice growth rate. And as you said, they've got a long runway. They don't have that many stores when you consider their retail operations out there and the various places they can get into to sell their products. So I think there's a long runway for them, and as I said, there's a long runway for the markets that they can go into with their products, as we said, Asia and Europe. So we have a lot of growth potential left. They haven't saturated the market with their products yet. So I'm big on this growth rate. I can get behind 15.6% on this. Let's talk about the discount rate. I struggle with this, and there's been a lot of debate about what's a good discount rate for companies. And I have my philosophies on this. And I think their discount rate can be significantly lower than the market. 12% is a pretty good market discount rate, and I've been going through a lot of thought process on this. It's one of the reasons I haven't done McDonald's yet, but looking at their absolute PE scores and looking at this these Katzenelson valuations, business risk 20 out of 20, excellent. Financial risk 20 out of 20, very little risk. Earnings predictability 12 out of 20, so they have a little bit of earnings predictability. But as we said, that it still looks very stable. When we look at their earnings predictability, what's been the problem here? They didn't grow their gross margin, so their gross margin didn't grow from 75%. So that's why that's down. Their net margin didn't grow from 24%. So that's why they got dinged there. It hasn't grown from 21%. It got dinged there. It didn't grow from 72%. They got dinged there. So they got dinged because they did very well in the previous years on this score here for earnings predictability. So it looks like they have some very, very nice metrics. And even when you score it like this, they're coming from such a high bar that the dips that make this look weird are minimal and kind of skew it in the wrong direction to making it look more risky. So I think the discount rate can be significantly lower than normal. As we said, they have no long-term debt to speak of. They have no short-term debt to speak of. All their liabilities are really tied up in commitments that they would make anyway. So I could see this discount rate being very, very low. Again, on the other side, and to invert this and see what could go wrong, they are in the fashion industry, and if they go out of style, they can get crushed very quickly. So we have to weigh that against their financial situation on how strong is their brand. So this discount rate is really going to be a factor of how well do I think they will be able to maintain their brand image. Being a company that's been around since 1941 and has maintained a high status brand gives them a nice moat and a nice cushion on their sales, because people want to buy it. People want to buy it because it is the brand, it is the status symbol that it is. And that's not something that goes away quickly, as a lot of fad businesses and a lot of fad brands can. So I see the brand being pretty stable. I can get them down to 7, but I'm going to be a little bit more conservative and say, let's do 9% just to be safe on the owner's earnings. As you can see, owner's earnings over the years has just grown consistently. It's been very, very nice growth with a couple of little down ticks, but nothing too crazy. And they've consistently rebounded. When they've had these two bad years, they've come right back. This year, they doubled in the year, the next year. So I see them as being very, very safe. I can give them 9%. I am getting a little bit squeamish on this from the Bed Bath & Beyond video when I had it at 7% there, so I'm getting a little more conservative with my discount rate, and 9% is probably a little higher. I could probably justify the 7, but I'm going to go with 9 on this. So let's do a refresh. So what do I see? I see a valuation of 96.33. So it gets me this 48% margin of safety. If I'd gone to 8, this would obviously have been below my margin of safety of 50%. But I see a 48% margin of safety, which is pretty strong, and I like that. So I'm getting a nice deal. I'm getting a nice stable company at a very nice discount from what I see. So what about free cash flow? How's that look? Let's go to free cash flow and refresh that. Free cash flow is not growing nearly as fast as owners' earnings are. 11.2%, but I can get behind 11% on that. I'll do the same 9% discount rate. So with free cash flow, we get a margin of safety of 32%. So it's kind of in one of those wait and see modes. If I go with owner's earnings, it's almost certainly going to be a buy here. If the price drops a little bit more, I could even say that I would buy it anyway. If I went with 8%, let's see what happens with 8% free cash flow. We get the 37% margin of safety, and with owner's earnings, we're at 53%. So I'm very close on a buy here, and I almost want to buy it. But if I keep with my metrics, I'm going to wait until it gets below that point with our 9%. So I'm going to have to wait until it hits 48.16, which could be any day, given the volatility of the market and where they are now. It's so close. So I'm going to look at this one. I'm going to keep watching it, and I'm going to be a buyer here in the very near future if this goes down. So that's what I have on COH. I think it's a good brand. I think they have a nice moat. I think they have a very solid financial statement. All the metrics seem to be pointing in the right direction. It almost seems like it's too good to be true. And on a lot of these, on how they're maintaining these brands and maintaining these financial statements. I'm not in the fashion industry. I see fashion as being a fad a lot of times, but there are cases like COH and like Chanel and some of these other big name brands that can just constantly maintain high returns and high earnings because people will consistently buy it just because of the name. And people buying you just because of the name is exactly why Warren Buffett bought Coke. People buy Coke because it's Coke, and it's a good product that they like. And I see COH as being in a similar vein, maybe not to that extreme, but they rely upon that brand economic moat more than anything. So with that, I wish you well and good luck on that. So I will see you next time. Take care.